afternoon. Well, I'm Vince. I'm the moderator for this panel. First of all, thank you very much for coming. Really, no, we all of us here, we've been to many conferences. We've spoken at a lot of conferences, but this is the first time ever that we stand between Jin Liu and Obama. It's an honor, but it's also a challenge. So, as a moderator, instead of kind of kick off this in a traditional way, which is introducing each of the panelists one by one, I'll kick off with, in a special way. I'll share with you a personal moment. Without this moment that happened to me a long time ago, I wouldn't have been here. I wouldn't do what I do now. That was a moment that happened to me long time ago when I was in high school. And it was a very casual after dinner conversation with my father. And at that point he said this to me, well, after you grow up, go get an MBA degree in an Ivy League school. Well, I know M, I know B, I know A. I have no idea what MBA is. Ivy League, well, I heard about this before, but which schools are Ivy League anyway? And back then I was 15 years old. My father, I grew up in a very traditional Chinese family, and I'm the only child. So naturally, they have a high expectation on me, on my future, on my career. And I'm fully aware of that. So from that point onward, I worked very hard, relentlessly and religiously towards this goal. And from that point onward, until 25, 26, in about 10 years, I've built and created a perfect resume for myself that got me into Yale School of Management with scholarship. And then, after I graduated from Yale, within 5 years, I've created, I founded and managed a $1 billion international fund for one of the biggest asset managers in US. That's the height of my finance career. What is that to do with education? Education changes life. It has changed my life. It has changed the lives of a lot of my friends and classmates. But, and yes, education system today is broken. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here to talk about different solutions. But learning is not. Learning is not broken. Learning will still be life transforming. But we know one thing will change for sure. It's talent. It's the definition of talent, the development of talent, even the assessment and the recruitment of talent. In my generation, talent means, or talent is only narrowly defined by a set of static measure. What school you go to, what degree you get, your GPA maybe, and that's it. But what about going forward? And for me, as a Generation X, in my generation, I'm regarded as a high potential talent, but will I still be a talent in the next 5 to 10 years? So for this panel, since again, we are before Obama's session, I'll be very conscious about time. We'll finish it before 2, and one of our panelists has to rush to the airport, so I'll make sure that we'll do this as efficient as possible. So the first question for the panelists, each and every one of you, in your own words, what does talent mean to you? Given what you do now, given what you have done, and given what you know about this world will evolve, what is your definition of talent? Start with Garrett.
I think in the context of what we're, by the way, my name is Garrett. I started a company called Handshake. It helps college students navigate their way into a career in America. We're broadly speaking super exposed and spend a lot of time thinking about talent. I think talent is the propensity and excitement around learning and growing. Talent, I think the big ones that I think we have on talent in the United States is that talent oftentimes it's a bit unfair in the States around how talent actually makes its way into a career. We like to say talent is evenly distributed, but opportunity really isn't. And oftentimes talent doesn't truly meet its full potential. So I think what we're focused on in Handshake is helping students really meet their full potential and understand, given their natural talents and given their gifts in education, you know, how can they focus that on a career that they find meaningful. So that's the lens of which I think about talent.
Okay, my name is Mary Sawada. I'm from a company called EduLab, Tokyo, Japan. We do a lot of assessment-related work for the government of Japan. So it's a great question. I think talent to me is being able to change to the world. And I'd like to use a word that Michael Moore used for his presentation, being able to Kaizen yourself and be motivated to do that, to adapt to the requirements around us.
Hi, everybody. My name is Xiaoting Huang, and I'm a faculty member at Peking University. Supposedly, I'm working with some of the most talented students in our country. And we do have a very structured view about talent, what talent is. I think it can includes three categories of abilities. One is the most fundamental cognitive skills, or the traditional curriculum-based skills like reading, math, writing. And the second category is cross-curriculum, higher order thinking skills, like the ones we've been talking about in the past 2 days. Critical thinking, collaborative problem solving, etc. And there are a third category of proficiencies. I think people are now more aware of that third category, which is the abilities or skills people need for their lifelong development, like social emotional skills, how you get along with your peers, get along with the society, how you self-regulate your own study or your work, etc. So I personally would call for more attention on the third category. That's what keeps us going for a lifelong time and keeps the society going.
Hi, my name is David Ross. I'm the CEO for the Partnership for 21st Century Learning in Washington, D.C. My entire organization has focused for 15 years now on a framework for talents, what we call skills. To me, talent is something that we are all born with. Every child has the ability to critically think and create and be communicate and be creative. But the more important question is, how do we develop them over time? How do we put children in, whether or even adult learners, in a context in which their talent can flourish, be developed? It's not something that's static, it changes over time. Now with the introduction of very sophisticated technology like AI, what does it mean to have these talents? How do we meld the human development of this talent by putting it in context and exercising it with the technology that's going to shape what this talent looks like in the future?
Now my next question is even more interesting. On a scale of 1 to 10, how do you rate yourself in terms of talent qualities? The talent as defined by you. And you know, no one is perfect. Like Jin talked about perfection, but in reality, no one is perfect, which is fine. But given your own assessment, your self-assessment, how would you like to bridge the gaps for yourself going forward, being a future relevant talent for this century? Well, start with David first.
I do both formative and summative assessments for myself, for the four C's are at the core of my organization's work. And we do employee evaluations, both self-assessments and peer assessments for each of the four C's. And traditionally, I have not been scored very high on my ability to collaborate. And part of that is personality. Part of that is the fact that I'm in a leadership role. And so I have had to work for this my entire life. I would give myself exceptionally high marks for creativity and communication and creativity. But it's an ongoing challenge for me to be collaborative. And so I need to work in an environment that's given me support and given me feedback to make me do that better.
I think this is a very well designed scheme. So we can choose to look either stupid or arrogant. I'm just kidding. OK, Okay. So as you've mentioned, each of us actually has a different definition of what talent is, and we are having, I think we do have different scales, like your 10 probably means 20 or 15 in my scale. So are talent scalable or are the skills comparable is my second question. And finally, to answer your question directly, I think if I read myself along, like doing research is my major work, so if I do my research alone, I probably get a 7 or 8. But if I collaborate with these smart people here, we 4 together probably can score more than 40. So that's my quick answer. Thank you.
Okay, so you threw me an even tougher question.
Well, I gave you a hint last time.
You
have the whole night to think of the answer.
But still, being from an assessment company, I have to be precise. And I think to my previous panelists explained a very good point about this talent, because there's huge terminology around this. And if you want to say something, you have to have a good defined definition of the talent, so you share the same kind of concept. As also, you have to explain, you know, there's like problems of reference biases, you know, and you know, people tend to over average, you know, difficulties. And these are things that we tackle in terms of assessments and metric systems. But going back to your question, I'd like to make it simple, just 3, okay. Let's say cognitive skills, intrapersonal skills, interpersonal skills. For cognitive skills, I need to work on my creativity. I kind of, you know, try to work on my success stories and depend on that. And also for my intrapersonal skills, more intellectual openness is needed. I think I'm getting old, so I need to absorb more new skills, I guess.
I've never been asked this question before. I think it's kind of interesting. You know, tell the crowd how smart you are, I guess.
Depending on your definition. Also, I think talent or smartness, so to speak, is multifaceted. It's not like just being smart or not smart.
Absolutely. I think a lot of what I fall back on is as I think about myself and I think about the people that are successful around me as well as the talent is really focused on, I think the word grit probably defines it best. I mean, you talk about your personal story, you know, at 16, finding your way to, you know, Ivy League education, Ivy League, the amount of grit and tenacity you have in order to persevere and stay disciplined through the course of time in order to make your way. I'm a firm believer in a work ethic, and I think obviously there's a natural born cognitive skill set that you're born with, and I was quite blessed to be, you know, I think born with a fast clock speed, but I think ultimately the type of talent that I see succeeding in my organization at Handshake is ultimately people that are really, you know, deeply believe in what they're doing, and they also have a lot of grit and focus around a common goal. And of course, you know, interpersonal skills, cognitive skills play into successful factors or more successful high performers, but in a team environment, I really feel it's a lot about grit.
Right. Now, in the interest of time, let's move on to the next part of this discussion. In like yesterday and today, a lot of speakers talk about, oh, you know, we need creativity, critical reasoning, analytical skills. We have noted, you know, about the 21st century skill set. The problem is a lot of time these skills are not easily observable, measurable, and monitored. So the assessment part is important. Now, that brings us to the next question. So we got 2 experts here, one from Japan, one from China, in terms of measurement. So I'll start with Nori. Could you share with us about in Japan, your experience in terms of assessing measurement of these so-called social emotional skills? And especially you used to work for ETS, which is basically focused mostly on academic skills. Now, what's your experience in Japan, and what are the challenges that you see there?
Okay, so the trend in Japan is about the social and emotional learning skills. One in, of course, K-12, and the other is in the early ages, like the kindergarten. And we provide metric systems still on development, and we do a lot of research around these areas. So let's say big five. And we all know the cost effectiveness of these traits or the skills. And we find that first of all, it's now measurable. It is measurable. It's just how well can you measure? And what's after you measure, how do you get better? You need to provide a playbook. What are that playbook going to be designed like? These are the things that the government in Japan is now looking for. And one way of measurement, the old traditional way was, you know, just Likert scale, self-evaluation, or cost-lead observation by a third party, right? But now we're trying to tackle this by metric systems, provide self-scaling systems, which uses new metric systems that can avoid three problems that you usually encounter in measuring this. One is the reference bias over the average problems and faking. And by I can't disclose the full ingredients, but one way of doing that is tackling this with a situational judgment process where you can avoid faking and a forced choice. So these mix of metric systems provide more accuracy to what you're getting as a result.
What are some of the, you know, up to now, what are some of the challenges that you see? Like maybe if you want to demonstrate that using example, like, you know.
Sure. First of all, one challenge definitely is in the very early ages. The metric systems works better after like grade 4 and above. If it becomes younger, it's hard for these young children to self-evaluate, and that's one. So for those ages, third-party observation works much better, I think. And second part is the playbook. We still need to work on the playbook, meaning that if you measure, you get the result, then what's next? What works better? How do we nurture these kind of skills?
Now, Xiaoting, so you are at Beijing Dashue, you know, that's your job in terms of like measurement, and you shared with me before in private about your work in working with the primary schools and also some of the university in China. Could you share with us, you know, especially we heard like his story in Japan. We'd like to hear about what happened here in China.
We actually try to measure university students' critical thinking ability using objective scales, meaning multiple choice questions with one right answer. I'm not a fan of self-rating scales. I think when we do self-rating, people use the rating scales differently, and we get very limited information from it. And objective measurements like using multiple choice questions, I think for now might be the best available option, but I'm still not satisfied because this is really not the real context people use their critical thinking or their collaborative problem solving. With the advance of educational technology, with the help of big data, we probably can find out a better way to analyze people's behavior, learning behavior online to get a better measurement. We actually measured, we assessed more than students from five local universities or three-year college, and I can share with the audience an interesting finding.
If you don't mind, yes.
Yeah. So we have students in their first, second, and third year, and guess which group of students get the highest score? Yeah, first year. Yeah. I think it's very like Chinese featured because once Chinese students get into university, they're kind of in the safe box. Our graduation rate will be close to 100, like 99% of the students can graduate from the school. So in their first year, they're still working hard, and before long, they figured, well, I can probably enjoy my life a little bit. So the second year students, they performed most poorly. And then in the third year, they kind of figured, well, I need to go to the job market now. Probably I should study a little bit. That's my guess. Actually, this is a plausible reason. We didn't find a way to prove it yet. But that's something we normally can't observe from their GPAs or their coursework scores.
In this study, what skills exactly?
Critical thinking.
Oh, okay.
Using multiple choice questions.
Oh, I see. Where do you see the, like, I mean, in China, what's the, these are all pilot plans, but in terms of, you know, hopefully at some point, a more scalable application of all these measurements, where do you see the future going? Especially in this society, which places a lot of emphasis on math, English, language skills.
Yeah, I think right now, teachers and educational policymakers, they are paying a lot of attention on these high order thinking skills in K-12, and they, if possible, they want to assess students like high school students and make it like a criteria for college admission. But this is, I think we have a long way to go, because first of all, these measurement tools or these instruments, although we have a very strong philosophical base for assessing this, but we don't have strong enough empirical base for it. We need to find out whether are these skills reliable enough. Do they have strong enough predictive power, etc. So this is one thing. And another concern is our teachers. They probably have no idea, or just a very vague idea about how to assess it, how to incorporate all these high-order thinking skills into their curriculum, their daily teaching. So it's really not fair to assess students something their teachers couldn't even define or teach.
Oh, fair enough, especially like, you know, with Gaokao, you know, the college entrance exam is kind of like being more and more like less academic, but still, you mentioned that still go a long way. Yeah. All right, The next question is for David, actually. I understand that while we hear comments from experts in Japan and China, you yourself actually have done a lot of work across the world, 15 countries, when it comes to measurement of these social emotional learning. Could you share with us some of the examples, maybe successful stories or even not so successful stories?
Sure. So I think I've done work around this topic in about 15 countries now, and what tends to happen is there's almost a universal agreement that creativity and collaboration and critical thinking and communication are essential skills, but then every country seems to choose a plus one format, meaning we'll do the four C's and then we'll focus on something that's important to our culture or more importantly to our economy. So for instance, I'm sure some of you are aware that the fine work Singapore and the Ministry of Education has done around entrepreneurship and innovation. I've worked in Korea for the last 3 years with the Korea Development Institute, and they say yes, the four C's, but we'd like to do something around entrepreneurship because we think the entrepreneurial skills are key to the success of Korea moving forward and becoming a post-industrial economy. In Costa Rica, the focus was on the four C's, plus what many people call ITC skills, information technology and computer skills, whether it's coding or something like that. So there seems to be an international core and then something that country finds important, again, to culture and to economy. But one of the things I want to sort of step back from that and address, and I want to agree with what you had just said, is I use the analogy of this is, I just did an analysis for Saudi Arabia has a new workforce readiness skills framework where there are 27 skills. Yes, the four C's are in there as well. But what I was trying to communicate to the Saudis is they're actually setting up their teachers for failure in that, here's the analogy. for more than a century, we've been teaching people how to play baseball. I'll use this as an analogy. We test and teach for content knowledge, science, math, literature, history, things like that. Now that everybody in the world wants to go towards socio-emotional learning, we're now asking people to play basketball. They're not equipped to do that. And so as we rush into these assessments of socio-emotional learning and things like that, and even if the instruments are valid and reliable and scalable, the problem is that in the classroom is we've never prepared students and teachers to teach, assess, receive feedback on that. So as these systems start to roll out, the initial scores, I don't even think are going to be a valid benchmark because nobody's taught this way before, nobody's learned this way before. So I have concerns.
Right, right. You mentioned about Singapore. In the world context, other than Singapore, what other maybe you also work with corporation other than countries? What countries or corporation that they you think they're quite advanced or proactive in terms of again assessing talent in a more kind of systematic, data driven manner?
I don't know that any one country's done that particularly well, but one of the things I'm fascinated about are the changes to the PISA assessments. And so PISA has experimented with assessing collaboration in a scalable way. They experimented with assessing creative, what they call creative problem solving. And then the next test in 2018 is going to test global competence or cultural competence as well. And one of the things that PISA is doing, and it fascinates me, and I don't know if this is a good or bad idea, but they're focusing on simulations. And so there's been some work done for 25, 30 years in educational technology, formerly using CD-ROMs, to create simulations to put kids into context where it's just not practical to have 4 million students engage in a real-world activity, and how do you observe and test that as well. So I think what PISA is doing may be a precursor to what a lot of other countries are going to do, rather than doing a standardized assessment of these particular skills, is a simulation-based approach. So I think that's the way that countries can also put their scores against the PISA scores and see if there's any kind of validity and reliability there. But that's my best example.
Right. Now, we talk quite a lot of assessment, not because I try to make this more kind of like a data-driven type of session. It's just that when it comes to talent or bridging the gap, obviously we need to assess where we stand in the whole spectrum of skills, and so that, you know, hopefully we'll be matched to the relevant kind of jobs. Now, when it talks about jobs, I would like to defer to Garrett. You are in the business of bridging the gap between career center or students, basically, at some of the U.S. universities, and the ultimate, you know, employers. Could you share with us about your approach to bridging the gap, especially before we even have a more standardized, scalable, robust system to assess talent, to measure talent? What's your approach to these pinpoints?
Absolutely. If we zoom out and just think about the main pain points and the way the ecosystem works in the United States is, yeah, college recruiting is highly fragmented. There's 3,000 universities in America. You know, there are roughly 350 universities that are, I'd say, like, relatively very high quality with on-campus employment opportunities. As an employer in America, the only way to connect with these students, oftentimes they're not on LinkedIn, they're not on many professionally oriented sites. So the way that most companies go about trying to find these students is actually showing up on campus. And in the States and in China, they have career fairs and info sessions and on-campus recruiting. But what ends up happening is that it's basically a large consumer brand and marketing exercise. Like a company like Google receives a lot of applicants and a lot of students because it's very cool what Google does. But you wouldn't know, for example, that Domino's Pizza, they consider themselves a technology company in the States. Their kind of PE multiple is way higher than other pizza companies because of their mobile application and their digital supply chain. So they're trying to hire engineers. But as an engineer, you're not going to walk up to Domino's Pizza, yet alone a second tier company on a hurry up. So what ends up happening is that there's a lack of access of opportunities because structurally it's very hard to scale across campuses. And then secondly, there's a lack of information, or there's information asymmetry. You know, students, you know, it's kind of the blind leading the blind. And what ends up happening, there's a lot of groupthink around what companies you should actually go into and what we should actually major in, and how to prepare professionally. So those are the major pain points. Companies really, they spend a lot of money trying to find recruit the right college students. And ultimately, the big metric that people are moving to from a talent perspective is not only cost per hire or how much you're spending on hiring talent. What is happening with a lot of millennials is they're churning out very quickly. You know, the average student in America has 3 jobs in their first 5 years. And oftentimes they're switching in between industries. So companies are spending a lot of money, the students are coming in for 1.5 years and then they're leaving. And so the way that we're trying to maybe break down that problem is, you know, today Handshake partners with over 500 universities in America, where we basically power the recruitment and hiring ecosystem on that campus. We're kind of the system of record for jobs and internships. Professors, faculty, students all think about our brand as this is the place I come to connect with employers. And then on the flip side, for employers, employers are able to come to one consolidated network to connect with any one of the students at 500 schools. Historically, this was like a very fragmented, digital landscape. And so what ends up happening is Handshake in America, we are the largest marketplace of high-intent college job seekers. You know, we have over 8 million college students on the platform, over 220,000 companies. And the big thing we're trying to do is take a very personalized approach. You talked about AI earlier. So how can we take a student in and take their industry interests, their major, their location preferences, their skills? How can we help that student in a more Spotify-like way recommend to you opportunities? Maybe say you're interested in engineering at Domino's Pizza, right? Like, how can we actually marry all these preferences and data we have about you with exposing you to new opportunities? So a lot of what we're trying to do is just enable more peer-to-peer learning and break down the information silos on these campuses. And then structurally, we solve for the access problem because employers can come to one network to recruit from any one of these universities, where historically it was very, very, very challenging to do.
Right, so the access value, but you know, in the future with your whole data set and plus some of the work that Xiaoting and David or even Laurie are doing, like eventually like the skills, the preferences, everything will be integrated. This would be is a whole kind of the not just skills gap, but like all the gaps kind of like in the ideal world. I know it's still a long way. But like I said, it's in the interest of time, unfortunately, I have to wrap up this session. I think the way I wrap up, instead of, again, making a generic conclusion, I'll leave the first few questions. The first few questions that I ask these panelists to you, again, in your own words, in your own mind, what is talent in this century, and how would you see yourself given your own definition, and how would you like to help yourself to bridge the skills gap, given the ever-changing world in the next century or not, or so? And I think this is an open question. This question won't have black and white answers. This question, if we come back next year, I think, if not me, someone else would try to answer, but it won't have just one answer. And I'll leave it to you. I believe that not only talent is unique, the way that you develop your own talent qualities will also be distinctive. So once again, thank you very much for your time, and thank you.